Hi, everybody. Welcome to my podcast channel. My name is Jen, and this is the first episode of In the Round. It's going to be a podcast about knitting, yarn, and the knitting community. So I wanted to start this podcast as a way to say hello as a knitter to the knitting community and hopefully find some more people that share the same hobby as me and love to knit. I also want to use this as a way to expand my horizons as a knitter and look at advancing my skills. Like I said, I've been knitting for a few years now. However, I don't feel like I'm adventurous. I stick to the same type of patterns, hats, scarves, a couple shawls here and there, but I'd really like to try some more advanced stuff. So I'm hoping having you guys to share my projects with along the way will actually motivate me to continue on and try new things. One of my goals for 2017 is a pair of socks. About 2 years ago, I did cast on a pair of socks, some toe-up socks, but right when I got to the heel construction, I felt really discouraged about them, and I stopped. I frogged them, I ripped them out, I salvaged the yarn, it's in my stash to try another day. So hopefully in 2017, it's my year, I'll get some socks done. So that's my goals for this podcast. This first episode though, I want to kind of focus on an introduction of myself as well as to share a haul with you guys from Stitches, and we'll get into that a little bit later. So like I said, my name is Jen. I've been knitting for almost 5 years, actually almost 6 years. I started because my grandmothers, both of them actually, crocheted, but the one I was closest with, she passed away from Alzheimer's and was not able to show me how to crochet, but I was able to get some of her crochet hooks and some of her yarn stash when she passed away. So since both of my sides of my family, both grandmothers crocheted, I really felt like it was something that I wanted to try to kind of carry on their memories in my heart. And I'm left-handed, so if you know anything about crochet, unfortunately it's a different direction when you do it with your left hand. And although it is possible, most patterns are created for right-handed crocheters, and I guess I'm just not smart enough. My brain could not figure out how to convert from one to the other, and so I got really discouraged by that. Well, during that process, I started researching knitting, and I read that there was a left-handed way and a right-handed way. There's not really, but it kind of gave me that confidence and that Kickstarter that, hey, maybe I could actually do this. So I took a class at my local Michaels for $20 or $25 for an hour and a half class, I think it was, and I've been knitting ever since. So I learned how to knit continental, which I was told was the left-handed way, so I felt really confident about that. Come to find out, it's not the left-handed way. There is no real left-handed way, but like I said, it gave me the motivation and encouragement to continue. What else? I've been married for almost 7 years. I've known my husband for almost 10. We have a 2-year-old son. He just celebrated his second birthday at the end of February. And we have a dog and 2 cats. So if anytime I'm filming and you hear some weird meowing or crying in the background, that explains it. One of my cats is a 2-year-old male and he's still very rambunctious. So he will probably lunge at me. So you may see him on camera at some point. There is a couch about a foot away from me here. So he may just be on the couch and decide he needs to be on me. So I apologize for any rambunctious activities that happen in the future. I think that's it about myself. Oh, where I live. I live in California, United States. I live in a small town outside of Sacramento, so the capital of California. I live in Citrus Heights, and when I say it's outside of Sacramento, I really mean it's outside. I have, the street I'm on is in Citrus Heights, and the next street over is Sacramento. So we're right there. But yeah, that's a little bit about myself. Right now it's nice and windy outside, a little bit of sun coming through the clouds, but that's not why you're here. You're here for knitting. So that's it about me. Let's get into Stitches. So if you're not familiar with Stitches is in the United States a big yarn convention, at least I think it's big because it's kind of the big one that I know of, and it happens multiple times throughout the year in different areas of the country. So the one that I went to was Stitches West, and this was actually my third time going this year, and it's in Santa Clara, California, which is about a 2.5 hour train ride, so it actually works out perfectly for me. We hop on a train in Sacramento, take a 2.5 hour train ride, you can knit on the train, no problem. You get there and you're right there. The convention hall or the convention center is probably about a block away from the train station, so an easy walk, and you get to spend the whole day there or a couple days, whatever you're doing, and then get back on the train and head back home. You don't have to worry about traffic, parking, gas, nothing like that, so it's awesome. But Stitches is a huge event. It's a week-long thing. There's classes, the designers come out and they teach classes, different techniques, there's pajama parties, all kinds of awesome stuff. So I encourage you, if you can, to get out to a Stitches event and really get to see what's out there. I brought home to show, this is the little pamphlet. I have it upside down for you guys, sorry. So this was at the end of February, and my husband actually surprised me with tickets to Stitches and the train ride. My son is born, his birthday was actually the weekend after, so it's always kind of hard for me to feel like I can go to Stitches because, you know, there's a party to plan, and I just kind of want to spend time with my family as well during that happy celebration. But my husband had taken care of everything for Valentine's Day. He actually had already planned with my mother-in-law to watch our son. He'd already gotten the tickets, he'd gotten the train. And he actually came with me. So this is the first year for him, and he's really, really supportive of my hobby of knitting, and he loves squishing yarn and looking at all the different stuff. So he had a blast. But I wanted to show you in this, the convention hall, or the marketplace, what they have is full, chock-a-block full of vendors. So this whole entire thing, I don't know if you can see the whole thing, that is all vendors. So different vendors, different indie dyers of yarn, big name places like Clover was there too, Malabrigo, things like that were there. But I mean, it goes from 103 as a booth to 1,433. So there's a ton of vendors, lots of awesome stuff to see. So I wanted to kind of show you what I purchased at Stitches in hopes that it's somebody new to you, someone you've never heard of, and maybe you can go check out their shops or Etsy stores or their websites and kind of see if there's something that you like there. So when I found out I was going, you can actually download the vendor list online. And so I spent a couple hours going through all of the vendors to see what they sold, if it was something I was interested in, and kind of making a shopping list for myself. And one of the things I was really interested in getting were some progress keepers. So I actually make my own stitch markers, just a jump ring with a little bead on them. So I wasn't really concerned about stitch markers, but I don't have any progress keepers to you know, mark myself if I'm knitting 4 inches. I can have the progress keeper on one spot and then, you know, where my needles are. So one of the places I saw was Miss Purl, MISSPURL, like a knit and stitch purl. But this is her little card. Her name's Danielle. It's got some little owls on the back. And I loved that they had little themes to them. So I love Doctor Who. My license plate is Doctor Who stuff. I'm a Whovian at heart. But if you know anything about the Doctor, there's all kinds of different phrases and ideas and stuff and themes around it. But one of the things I loved, I'm just going to take these out so you don't hear the clinking of them. She had this little tin to keep your notions in it. It's like one of those, like an old Altoids tin. I know it's not an Altoids tin, but just kind of the same idea. But she has little paper on the front, and it's sealed on, so it's nice and tough on there. But Doctor Who fans, you always have the doctor that's yours, your doctor, your favorite one. And mine was David Tennant. And one of the phrases he always said was Allons-y, which I believe is French for let's go. So right on top here, it actually says Allons-y, so I love that. I grabbed that. And then I got a set of Doctor Who stitch markers. and progress keepers. So what I liked about these, and there were different options, you can get it with just a ring on the top, or you can get it with a lobster clasp, or you can get what I did, which was it had both. So I really loved that feature because it came with your ring, so it's just a simple metal, you know, jump ring basically, and then a progress keeper on a lobster clasp. So you can actually put them together, maybe, here we go. And then as you're knitting, if you know you're gonna need a progress keeper, you can just remove this and use it. So I really loved that feature. So this one is blue, and of course that one has the TARDIS on it. So if you know anything about Doctor Who, TARDIS is his time machine basically, his little spaceship that he travels around in. And then the green one has a little sonic screwdriver, which is not his weapon. I wouldn't call it a weapon. It's kind of his tool that he uses to do his quests, I guess. The yellow one has a little alarm clock on it because he's a Time Lord, so time travel. The red one has a bow tie because the one of the other doctors wears a bow tie. And then the orange one is just a little silver tab that has the word companion on it. And the doctor is a Time Lord, but he always has a companion that travels with him that kind of just is his friend during all his travels. And I've always wanted to be a companion and travel with the doctor. So check her out if you're looking for stitch markers, things like that. I know she does a lot of conventions, so I don't think that her Etsy shop has a lot of her stuff on there, but check her out on Instagram, you know, and message her and see what she's got. She may have some stuff that she doesn't have listed, but she had all kinds of different themes and different colors and things like that. So really well made. I really enjoy them. I can't wait to start them on a project. So like I said, my husband came with me to Stitches, and one of my friends from my knitting group actually had gotten this project last year at Stitches, and so she showed me a photo on her Ravelry page. So I went home and showed my husband, and this company was actually at Stitches this year, so he wanted to get the product. And he said, you know what, I have some money set away for his Stitches, so he wanted me to pick this up for him. So it's called Dragon Scale Mitts by Colette's Garden. So colettesgarden.com. And they are dragon mitt or dragon scale mitts. So it comes in three different sizes. You've got your wristlets here. In the center here is a mid-length, and then you've got your long here. So you get the pattern, and then you actually get these little bags of scales. So depending on what size or length that you're going to be knitting, you get your bags of your scales. And they're these cute little metal scales. So it just kind of looks like a dragon scale, and it's got a hole in the top so you can knit through it. And like when I say metal, it's not sharp. I mean, I'm scratching myself. It's not, you know, it's moving, not leaving any scratches or anything like that. But so you get the scales to go with it. And he picked out black. Oh, we're getting some sun all of a sudden. So he got three bags of black, some emerald green, and then his very favorite were these are plastic glow-in-the-dark ones. And so, excuse me, Colette was there, and one of the things she said was that these glow-in-the-dark ones are new this year, and she was really excited about them because, you know, when glow-in-the-dark plastic really first came out in, like, I don't know, the 70s or 80s, it was kind of yellow. Well, these are actually, like, a green, so they're a green glow-in-the-dark. So my husband likes mythical creatures, so the dragon thing was awesome for him, but he also likes comic books, which his favorite superhero is DC Comics Green Lantern. So what he wants me to make with these dragon scales is have the scales in black, but on the hand, he wants me to put the Green Lantern symbol in the glow-in-the-dark ones. The Green Lantern symbol is a circle with two lines on top, so it shouldn't be too difficult, but it's something I'm gonna have to do before I start my pattern. So look for those as I start those, that'll be fun. Well, since it was his project, I told him, hey, you've got to do it all yourself. Besides the actual knitting, you've got to plan it out. You have to get your project, you have to get your scales, all the materials, which included yarn. So while we were there, he was on the hunt for some yarn. This project actually takes worsted, and I will say that's one thing I noticed at Stitches was that I don't know if worsted is just not in this coming season, but it was a lot of sock weight, a lot of fingering stuff, and some places did have worsted, but he was looking for something particular. But we ended up going with this gorgeous yarn. It's worsted weight by Shirsty Cat, so thirsty but Shirsty. I like it because I love cats. I've got two of them. But her little label is a kitty cat whose tail turns into a ball of yarn. Isn't that cute? But this colorway is called Bees with an exclamation point. She made sure to let my husband know that you have to say the exclamation point. But it's this really pretty tonal black that then goes into like a highlighter green. So I'm trying to find, yeah, like in the center here. I'm hoping you can see that. It is gorgeous highlighter green. And then you've got these nice black tonal into it as well. So this will be the base. It'll have the black scales and then the green lantern in the glow in the dark. And he got the green emerald ones just because, I mean, I don't know what he's gonna make me make him with that, but that's what he got. So I told you my goal for 2017 is socks. And I wanted to find some yarn that I knew could be socks. So I found this self-striping yarn, and it is by Biscotti Yarns. So biscottiyarns.com, they're actually on Ravelry as well. So you look at some awesome projects. And this is the melon colorway. So I like Doctor Who, and I like watermelon. Well, they had a huge poster up of all these self-striping colorways, and I saw one that was melon. So I jackpot watermelon socks. So one of the reasons I picked this as well is because I wanted something that every time I looked at it in my stash, I know it's gonna be socks. Without having to go extreme and purchase a bunch of more stuff, a bunch more colorways and skeins, I cannot see this being anything but socks. So I'm hoping that's the motivation I'll need to cast these on. But it's an 85 superwash merino and 15% nylon blend. It's squishy, it's soft. We can do the squish face test. Nice and soft, but absolutely gorgeous colors. I mean, it definitely looks like a watermelon. You've got your dark fleshy reds, you've got some pink, you've got some lighter white, some lighter green for the rind, you've got the dark green for the rind. But what I also like is when this is knit up, and you can see projects on Ravelry, this part that's on my finger is this really kind of mid-tone brown, but when it knits up, because it's self-striping, those knit up into like seeds. So I thought it was really awesome. One person did actually use the same yarn to make a shawl, and or it was more like a wrap, it was huge, but the center piece was basically this knit up, and so it kind of curved down and decreased towards the end, and then above and below they had matching skeins of different colors in that. So like the green, two different color of green, some red and pink. So that's when I say I don't see this being anything but socks unless I go extreme. That's the extreme I'm talking. It was absolutely gorgeous and it was beautiful, but I'd have to do so much more than just cast these on and make socks. So sock, watermelon socks, awesome. I actually have a watermelon hat I'll have to show you at some point. Yes, when I said I love watermelon, I love watermelon. I've made a watermelon hat with little seeds and stuff. So that was that. One of the projects that I really wanted to work on, it was actually on my shopping list for Stitches, was the three-color cashmere cowl. It's been all over Ravelry, all over podcasts for maybe 6 months now, and I really wanted to cast it on. A little bit different for me. I've never used cashmere, so I wanted to attempt that. But a lot of places I looked for a skein of cashmere was like $30 or $40. Understandably, it's absolutely soft and gorgeous and beautiful. So I wanted to see what I could find. We actually found a place called Neighborhood Fiber Co. And they actually made a kit. And right on the package, it says the pattern's not included. And I was totally fine with that. Totally okay. It's like a $7 pattern. I will purchase that. But the kit itself with just the three colors of cashmere was $55, which I thought was a steal. That was awesome. Especially, like I said, if one skein was roughly about $30 to $40, depending on where you went, you get enough of each of the colors to do your cashmere cowl. And they actually even labeled it for you, so you kind of have, you know. But this is 80% wool, 10% cashmere, and then it has a 10% nylon to kind of give it a little more strength. Look at these colors. So can you guess what my favorite colors are based on this? Purple and green. I love purple and green. This is my jam. Make sure I'm in the camera here. This is my jam. This is what I would wear on a normal basis. So, I mean, I absolutely love it. They are so soft, so squishy. That cashmere is just divine in here. So they labeled the colors for you, which is great. This is the color A. So this is, I believe, what I will start with. I haven't purchased the pattern yet. This is called Lauraville, and it's this beautiful tonal lilac, kind of like a lavender. So you've got some dark lavender up here, goes into some light right there. So it's absolutely gorgeous. Then it's gonna go into this blue color, or B color, excuse me, which is Remington, which is, again, just a nice tonal, but this one is like a royal, like violet. And then C color is a fun name. It's Anacostia or Anacostia. I'm not really sure, but gorgeous. Almost reminds me, I like watermelon. So the dark part of a watermelon rind, that dark green. But the three of these together, I'm just absolutely so excited for. I think this is gonna look great. I think this might be my next cast on. I don't consider the socks like a cast on. Everyone says, well, I have socks going all the time. It doesn't count. So I'm going to try to take that mindset when I do my stuff. So I think this will be my next cast on. What else? So I went with like ideas to do no kits. I didn't want kits. I ended up with pretty much all kits, which I'm fine with. Totally fine. I just kind of wanted to branch out a little bit more. But I'm totally happy with my purchases. The next thing I purchased was something called the Versatile Hat. So you guys know that right now the messy bun hat is huge. It's all over. I saw a bunch of it during Christmas time being sold in shops and on Facebook groups. Well, this is a versatile hat, and I would show you the picture, but the picture's really hard to see. But it is by Foxy Knits, and it's a cute little pattern where it's a hat and it has a drawstring at the end. So you can wear it with the drawstring, you know, tight, and it's a hat. You can open the drawstring and put your bun through it, or you can open the drawstring all the way and it becomes a cowl. The pattern not only includes, you know, how to do that, but it actually shows you how to do just a hat, so there's no drawstring at the end or just a headband. And as a kit, I got the pattern and two of the skeins of yarn I would need to complete it. Purple. So top is a gorgeous, beautiful kind of, you know, violet tonal purple. And then this other color, it's hard to describe. It's got a lot of, it's definitely variegated. It's got some dark blues, some really light, a little bit of teal, some light pinks and purples, and it's even got some little speckles of blue. So I'm excited to see what this is going to look knit up when I cast on this hat. So the Versatile Hat by Foxy Knits. Another thing I purchased was knitting needles. So when I first started knitting, like I said, I was doing a lot of hats and things like that, which were mostly on 16 inches. I didn't know how to do magic loop yet, and it was too advanced for me at the time. But I would do a lot of 16 inches, and you know, one hat would be on 6, one would be 7, one would be 8, and it was starting to, like, you know, hey, this is a lot. If I have to get 16 inches, or you know, 16 inch, and then a 20, and you know, all these different things. So I heard about interchangeable needles. And my husband's really savvy when he looks on internet and things like that. So he actually found a company that would do a 16 inch. So your needles are a little bit smaller. Usually they're 4.5 inches, but this one for this set is 4 inches, and then you get the length of needles, or excuse me, the length of cable you need. Well, he purchased for me the 16-inch special set from Knitters Pride, or Knit Pro, depending on where you are. I think Knit Pro is European, but it's the same company, so they are interchangeable. But he got me the 16-inch set, which was great. I love it, but it only came in wood, and I wanted to kind of expand and try some metal needles, because I know that metal usually tends to be a little slicker with certain types of yarn. So I went on to their website, and it's about $60, $45 to $60, depending on where you're purchasing from, for the set. And so I started looking around, and I actually found a woman near me on Craigslist that was selling 3 sets. And by the time I got to her, she had 1 set left, and she said, "I'll give it to you for $20. And I was like, "Oh, awesome. That's great. You know, $40 to $20 or, you know, whatever. I'm totally fine with that." She goes, "Well, there's one problem. One set of the needles is missing, size 7s. And I said, "Okay, you know, not a big deal. I can easily buy a set of needles." And so that was about 4 or 5 years ago, and I finally, at Stitches, purchased my size 7 circular needle metal tips. Excuse me. So these were $8. I figure if I save $20 or $40 buying it a set used and I had to replace just this, I'm down. That was totally fine. So I got those. Another thing I purchased, I love Doctor Who. We talked about that. I love watermelon. We're huge Disney fans, and my favorite movie is Beauty and the Beast. And before you ask, yes, I saw the live action. I've seen it twice. I actually saw it in Disneyland. So love it. Go see it if you haven't seen it. It was awesome. But I have Beauty and the Beast purses. I've got a Beauty and the Beast tattoo on my back. So when we saw this project bag, a friend of mine was actually at Stitches, and she saw it and told me, "Jen, you have to go get this bag." So I did. But it is from Little Skein in the Big Wool. And it's just a cute little drawstring bag. It's got the black on the bottom, which I like because it's going to protect it. If I put it in something, it's not going to look dirty. And it's kind of like a canvasy feel. But it's got cute little Beauty and the Beast theme on the outside. It's got coordinating fabric on the inside. And at first I was just like, you know, it's a cute bag. I love it. I was going to get it anyway. But the designer said, "Did you actually look at the fabric?" And I was like, "No, it's got Beauty and the Beast on it. That's all I need to know." But she said that what she does is she actually finds a theme. So in this case, it was Beauty and the Beast. And she contacts designers and has them design a fabric for her that is yarny, as she described it. So I don't know if you'll be able to see this, but where my fingers are pointing is a ball of yarn and 2 knitting needles. The ball of yarn actually is a rose. So Beauty and the Beast rose ball of yarn. And then, where is it? Oh, right here. The teacup is being poured into, trying to see if I can get you to see that. Let me stand up and show you guys. The teacup right there is being poured into from that teacup or teapot, and it's yarn. So let me see if I can find that. It's kind of hard to see it this way. So here's a ball. Whoop, maybe, there we go. A ball of yarn that's actually a rose. So really, really pretty. I absolutely love the bag. It's a great little size. So Little Skein in the Big Wool. She has a lot of different bags, different sizes. So that was one of my favorite purchases, just because it was Beauty and the Beast. What else? So kits. I said I purchased some kits. So I love packaging, and I love kits that come with everything you need. And this one company called Stunning String Studio just floored me. Their display was amazing. A lot of whites. My husband kept referring to as the white display place, but it was Stunning String. They are on Etsy, and their Etsy store is just as amazing as the actual in-store, or, you know, the vendor booth was. One thing I loved is they had displays of everything. So they had a sample knit up of absolutely everything, and they had kits right underneath it. Well, underneath the sample, they also had little pre-printed post-it notes. And it would have like the pattern, and it would come with a little thing on the bottom that said, create your own. Two skeins of stunning superwash, Moroccan blue and natural shone. So if you didn't like the colors that they had, it told you from the create your own, go to this area which had their, you know, stunning superwash and pick two skeins. So you can pick whatever two skeins you want to make your own kit if you didn't like the colors. So I loved that. So people were grabbing these and going. It was a really awesome marketing thing. I loved it. Obviously, I grabbed one. Well, I got two kits from them, and they were greatly priced. They were awesome. So this one kit, they're both shawls. I know I said I was going to branch out, but they're really pretty, so shush. This shawl is called the Moana or something. Moana kit. Sorry, I don't know how to speak Hawaiian. I love the packaging. Isn't this gorgeous? It's in a great organza bag. It has a little progress keeper on the top that says Aloha. It's a removable stitch marker progress keeper, so it's like a safety pin, but it has the big rounded butt, little big rounded bottom. And it has a little little charm on it that says Aloha. And one thing I loved about this project, this kit, is it comes with all you need. So it comes with, this one came with two skeins of this absolutely gorgeous, gorgeous yarn. This yarn is their Serenity base, which is 80% superwash merino and 20 silk, sorry. So soft. This is the reflecting pool. And I mean, it's just that. It looks like you're looking into a reflecting pool. You've got this gorgeous blue aqua and this pretty green. So you get two of those. You get 550 beads because it is a beaded shawl. You also get, this came with, I believe this is 49 stitch markers, because you'll need stitch markers for this project, so you need 49. They provided them for you, which is awesome. And these are just little plastic rings, blue and white. I don't know, I haven't looked at the pattern yet, if that matters, the blue and the white aspect to it. But one of the nicest parts of this that I liked was that here's what the shawl's gonna look like. And I got the small size. There was a large size as well, which went like, it looked like, I mean, I'm 5'2", and it looked like if I wore it, it would go down to the floor. That wasn't feasible for me. So I got the small size, but I loved that on the back of this is a Ravelry code to get the pattern. So I think this kit was $49 or $50 for all of that, including the pattern, which is absolutely amazing. I thought that was great. Such an amazing bargain. And I loved the idea to have all of that included and just in this cute little package, ready to go. I used the colors that were already in the pack. I didn't change the skeins or anything like that because, one, I really didn't notice that until after I bought these, but I was also really happy with the color. So I got that one, and then this one, which is the Tranquil Mist. So again, organza little bag. The little progress keeper that comes with this is removable. It's, again, another one of those little, you know, paper or safety pins, but it's got a little heart crystal. This one caught on myself here. Oh no. What's happening? I'm stuck. There we go. Again, if you can hear that, beads, because apparently I like shawls with beads. This one comes with the 11 stitch markers you need. These are little metal ones in a cute little heart case. Here's what the project's gonna look like. So Tranquil Mist. And again, it's got the Ravelry code on the back. And then this is their Exceptional Lace, and it's in the Blissful color, so it's just kind of a gorgeous, just kind of muted baby blue, we'll say. This is just superwash, 100% superwash merino. Very nice and squishy. So excited about that one as well. Like I said, their marketing was just awesome. Just, I think this one was $39. And again, you can get these same ones on their Etsy shop. And their Etsy shop shows the different colors available. And I guess I saw one because I, of course, had to look and see what else they had. But one of their kits, they said they got to the limit of how many colors they can put in the drop down for Etsy. And so they said, if you see another color that you want, just put it in the notes. They're so awesome. And I also got from them some of those little removable stitch markers. This was for $4.99. It was 28 assorted, so 2 of 14 colors. And they had all kinds of different little sizes. They had a big, like, 100 pack of all gold, of all silver. I wanted just cute little ones there. So I have one more purchase, and this was kind of a big purchase because it was pretty expensive, but I thought it was awesome. So my husband talked about wanting to learn to knit, and we kind of talked about it on the way there, and he was just like, oh, you know, what if you taught me how to knit? And I was like, okay, fine, whatever. But while we were there, we were done. I had kind of shopped myself out. We'd gone around the whole marketplace 10 times or so, looked at everything, or so I thought. As we're about to leave, I looked at my husband, I said, I'm good, we can go. And he said, well, there's one thing I want to look at. I want to look at this booth that was selling hexagon needles. I said, hexagon needles? And he said, yeah. I said, okay, we'll go over. And so we went to this booth, and the gentleman that was working was actually speaking to another woman, and he kind of looked at me and was like, have you ever used hexagon needles? And I was just kind of waiting, and I said, no. And he goes, here. And he grabbed a little yarn bowl that was in front of him and kind of scooted it down to me and said, start knitting. I was like, okay. So he had a project. It was just, you know, something knit in the round. And so I'm knitting, and I'm looking at my husband. I said, wow, these are really nice, really comfortable. And the gentleman kind of looked at me real quick, and he says, knit two together. I said, well, okay. And so I knit two together. I was like, wow, that was really easy. And I'm a very, very tight knitter. I'm gripping those needles. So the fact that it was able to slide in really quickly and easily was a surprise to me. I said, wow. And he goes, make one. I was like, okay. And so I made one. I was like, wow, that's really easy. And then the bane of my existence, he said, knit one front and back. I was like, oh, for me being a tight knitter, that is so difficult to do. It was like butter. It slipped in. And so I kind of listened to what he was saying, and the whole point of the hexagon needle was, a knitting needle is circular. It's circle, and so when you've got your needle and then you've got your yarn, it can touch the whole entire surface of the needle, and there's not a lot of space for you to be able to slide in to knit the next stitch. With the hexagon needle, a hexagon is a pencil, so you've got the points. So because of those points, when you have your yarn on there, even as a tight knitter like myself, there's still some space to be able to get the needle through. So we purchased some needles. I'll read the little package here. So it's from Indian Lake Artisans. So it says, the hexagon shape allows for easy control of needle handling while producing uniform stitches. The unique shape allows the beginning knitter to quickly master control of the needles and the advanced knitter to knit for longer periods of time with less muscle fatigue and hand stress. I will say, I'll show you a project in a second that I'm working on with these needles, and I mean, I can go hours on it. My hands don't hurt, and I don't know if that's just a mental thing or not, but I also noticed that I can go into my knit stitches very, very quickly. So Indian Lake Artisans, and I will say they were a little bit more expensive. We got a set of straights for my husband, and he got 10 inch size 8 cherry wood. And the wood is walnut, cherry, or birch, and that was a way to determine the strength or hardness of the wood, which also correlated to like the slickness. So like wood, metal, or plastic or acrylic needles, they all, you know, move a little different with different yarns. But they are truly a hexagon needle, and they've got these cute little copper tops to them. So this one's a little fish. And they say that I'll actually patina with time. So my husband's excited to kind of see how those change throughout the course of them. But I got a size 6, 24 inch circular. And the project I'm working on is in here. And it's hard for me to show you this, but they did have interchangeable as well. And this is not an interchangeable. This is a fixed needle. They had an interchangeable set. And like I said, they are expensive, but I honestly, I kind of want them. They were $300 to $400 depending on what sizes you picked. And I'll show you why I want them. When you have any fixed or circular needle, there's a join. And, excuse me, it does not come off. You have the join and it's connected. It's fixed, duh. With an interchangeable, there's a place for you to take off your needle. And usually it's after the join. Well, with these needles, and it's kind of hard to show you, but I am holding the cable 100% still. It is not moving. The needle, and again, this is a fixed needle, rotates at the join. It joins inside the needle, but it allows you to rotate. So if you're in the round and you're knitting and something happens and you get kind of, your cable gets twisted and needs to correct itself, you can do that without rotating the whole entire project or having to kind of fiddle with it. I love that. And their interchangeables do the same thing. So with the interchangeable, here where the metal meets the wood is where you're going to unscrew, but your join is back here between the cable. And the cable, very flexible, very soft, absolutely amazing needles. I think the circular was like $31 or $30 and the straights was about $25 or $30. So like I said, the interchangeable was $300 to $400. They do have a website. They were actually sold out while we were there. They said people just gobbled them up, which is awesome for them. I was really happy to see that because I may have kind of gone bankrupt trying to do that. Something I can definitely save up to. But I do actually really, really enjoy the needles. It's been awesome to knit with those. So those are my purchases, but there was one more thing that I saw there that I really enjoyed and something that it's a project that I'm gonna kind of work with. They had a booth called Alice's Embrace. And they got this little pamphlet and it says, providing hand knit and hand crocheted prayer shawls and lap blankets to comfort those suffering with Alzheimer's disease. So like I said, one of my grandmothers did pass away with Alzheimer's and I love the idea of giving back and being able to hopefully help somebody in that comfort and deal with that disease. And so it says, in 2014, Alice's Embrace was created in memory of Alice, who passed away May 29th, 2011 at the age of 79. She lived the last 6 years of her life with Alzheimer's disease. The purpose of Alice's Embrace is to provide comfort and warmth to those suffering with Alzheimer's. This will be possible with the help of generous people who knit and crochet for us. Choose one of our special patterns, and they said their patterns were actually named after her favorite memories or things about Alice's life. You choose a yarn, choose to make either a prayer shawl or lap blanket, create the item, wash the item, send item to Alice's Embrace, or take it to a partnering yarn shop. And what she said they do is that they go around to memory centers or care facilities and talk about their program, and if the facility says, yeah, we'd love to have you come out, they ask how many blankets they would need. And if the care facility says, we've got 30 people, she said, you know, they say, okay, we'll bring 60. They do that so that it becomes more personalized to the people. And instead of just being a blanket that, oh, was given to me, they get to choose which one they like, the different patterns, different colors and things like that. Which I remember with my grandmother, it was, everything was patterns and, if something was out of place and she didn't remember it, it kind of disturbed her and really upset her. So I think having something that they get to pick and that it's their choice, I want this blanket versus this one, really is going to help with their disease and their condition. I also love that this is in Elk Grove, California, which is probably about an hour from me, so I could easily send them one or drop it off. And I think I'm going to start one. I'm going to contact them and get a pattern pretty quickly here. And I think I'm just going to have one going all the time, just kind of as a way to use my knitting skills, as well as to kind of give back and kind of just in memory of my grandmother, who I think would have enjoyed something like this. So Alice's Embrace, they have a website if you want more information, alicesembrace.com, if you want to kind of help them out there. So that's all I had from stitches, but I kind of want to kind of show you what I've been working on, what I finished recently, and what I have on my needles right now. So what I've completed recently, and I just took this off of my blocking mat last night, was the very first shawl kit that I purchased at my very first stitches 4 or 5 years ago. I went right after I started knitting. So I started knitting in like November, and then in February, I went to my first stitches. So this was a kit I purchased, and it's called the Starry Starry Night shawl, or wrap, I guess. But it starts here, and it's got like a circle, and there's a little hole here, and then it's nice and long, and there's beads all around the edge. And how you wear it, I'm gonna do this without messing myself up here, is you do this, and then the end here goes into that little hole. You can't really see it because I'm kind of zoomed in here, but and it's got this great lacy pattern, and I actually love it. This colorway, I don't know, it was kind of a kit, so I don't really remember. I think it's on my Ravelry page. I do have a project for it. I believe it's called Legacy, but it's this gorgeous like grays and taupes and whites, and it's absolutely gorgeous. I love it. I wish I would have done a little bit longer, not like width wise but length, just so there was a little bit more that would come through the hole. Or maybe I just have really broad shoulders. I did the large size, but this was actually pretty, excuse me, out there for me as a knitter, especially if I just had started knitting, because I'm not gonna give too much away about the pattern because it's really, really a fun knit. But basically you start knitting in the center here and you work outways. So you're knitting here and going this way. So it's growing long instead of, I'm growing wide instead of long, which was different for me, especially with this keyhole design here. So if you're interested in that, pick up the pattern to see how to do this. It was actually very, very cool for me to do. But I cast that on probably in February of 2013 or 12, I think, 12. I cast this off 2 weeks before my son was born in 2015. So it took me a long time, not because it's a hard pattern, I just didn't pick it up. And like I said, I'm a really, really tight knitter. So unfortunately I bound this off, just a normal standard bind off, not reading the last line of the pattern that said use a stretchy bind off. So I bound this off and went to wrap it around myself, and I could barely get it around my neck with the loop because it was so tight. And I was like, oh no. And I still had plenty of yarn left over. So what I actually had to do is, just recently in the last month, I finally unbound it, took all the beads off, bound it again, bound off, but I used the Jenny's Surprisingly Stretchy Bind Off. But I knew that obviously I was adding more yarn to it, and I had already cut my yarn. So I had to research some ways to fix that, and I actually tried a new technique, which was the, I guess it's called a wet join, where you take your two ends and you get them wet and you kind of friction together. And it actually kind of felts it a little bit, but it helps it stick together. My knitting instructor said, you know, you probably don't want to do that. I wouldn't do that on a bind-off edge. I'd probably rip back a couple rounds and then do that join somewhere in there. I probably should have, probably could have, but I'm lazy and I didn't. But I will tell you, I think the join is somewhere like here. Don't know, can't tell you. It looks awesome. So if you're looking for a way to join, potentially on a bind off, something like that, the wet join was actually really nice and easy for me. Another thing that I have just completed is some test knits for my knitting instructor. Her name is Lorna Hardy on Ravelry for the pattern, and it's called Variations of a Vest. So I have two different variations here. This one here I made for my son, and it's just a cute little vest. But if you notice, most vests are either knitted top down or bottom up, or you can kind of construct it piece by piece, like front or back. This one, you actually start on the sleeves and you knit that way together and then you join it together. So the stitches on the back are actually sideways. I love the pooling on this. It's just red heart. I was just trying to testing it out, but I made this one for my son. So this is the variation of a vest, pointless. And then this one, same exact pattern, except for some quite little changes to make it a pointed version. So see how the ends point and there's only one button? So obviously I made this one for a little girl. And I absolutely love both of these patterns. They're great, they're on Ravelry. I think they're like $4.99 or $5.99. Really fun knit, really adventurous. I got to do some grafting, you know, and this was different for me, so this was kind of a little adventure. Very easy. I think I knit, these are both the six, or this one's a 6 to 12 month and size, and this one I think is the 1 to 2 because my son's pretty small for his age. I think my son's took me maybe a week and a half, and I ended up knitting like 3 or 4 of these because I had a bunch of coworkers have little babies right within a week, like literally a week. I had 2 boys, a girl, and then another coworker said they were pregnant with a little girl, so another one's coming. But I think this one, which was the 6 to 12 month, I did in 4 days. So cast on to bind off. Very fun. If you need a quick, cute little pattern, there it is. Those are what I have done. Love to show you what's on my needles. So you kind of already saw the project, but I want to show you actually, you know, what it is. In my Beauty and the Beast bag, I have the Brighton cowl. And it is this gorgeous cowl. So you knit it and then you are going to graft it together. But it's just basically repeats of a garter. And then this really pretty, it's so hard to see on camera, especially because it's not blocked, star pattern. Absolutely gorgeous. The yarn is so beautiful and variegated. It's Miss Babs. If you've never heard of Miss Babs, you should look her up. Beautiful, beautiful color. This has got some great aqua, and actually this colorway is called Brighton. So I don't know what the connection is. Like I know that she, the woman who designed it actually works for Miss Babs, but I don't know if she named it after the yarn or if the yarn was dyed for the pattern. I'm not sure, but absolutely gorgeous. This has been knitting so easily on these hexagon needles. So I'm excited. I just keep grabbing it and I bring it with me to work. And I knit on my lunch a couple rows a day. It's awesome. So very pretty. And I love that the pattern actually shows you the importance of blocking. So the star stitch is gorgeous on its own. It looks really pretty. But if you block it correctly and really stretch it out, they actually show that on the pattern. So they have a photo of it unblocked. It looks gorgeous. But then they show it blocked out and it is absolutely amazing. The different definition you get, it really shows off your yarn. So there's that. Another thing I'm working on, and I started this, my other shawl, the Starry Starry Night shawl, I finished that and I cast this one on immediately. My son is 2, so this has been on my needles for almost 2 years, but it is so long and it is not the pattern. The pattern is gorgeous. The yarn is gorgeous. It is me. It is so big at this point that it's kind of like, I want to be done. But it is called the Tubularity, and it is an amazingly easy knit. It is basically stockinette, and you've got some increases. I dropped my yarn ball, hold on. You've got increases and decreases on every single row. And trying to not tangle myself up here. It is absolutely gorgeous, and I'm so excited that I'm on my last one, but it is 7 different colors. So it is amazingly large. I am not gonna be able to get it all on one screen. So started here, and I'm all the way here on this gorgeous purple. The color, the yarn, is from Mosaic Moon, who I actually found, it's a co-op. My cat is attacking the wall. Yeah. It's a co-op group on Ravelry. they do co-ops where she dyes beautiful colorways. She does custom colorways. Maybe in my next episode I can show some of her stuff. She was actually at Stitches. I didn't purchase anything from her because I have too much of her stuff right now. But once I knit some more stuff, I can definitely purchase some more from her. But this is what she calls a deconstructed set. Here is the colorway, and the colorway is called, this is Severus Snape variation, which I believe she took out pink or black. I'm not sure, but it definitely was a different color. So if you like these set, make sure you get the variation one. But what a deconstructed set is all of these other colors are in the colorway. So the colorway's here, and then all of these colors come from inside that. And they're just gorgeous semi-solid variegation colors. It's beautiful, it's soft. I'm so excited about it. But if you've never heard the tubularity, it is a long tube. And it's, so, you know, a tube. And eventually, I already picked the buttons, but I will have three buttons on the side. And so there's multiple different ways you can wear this. You can wear it just wrapped around 100 different times because it's so long. When I block this, it's gonna like grow 600 feet. But with the buttons, you can then, oh my, he hit the camera. Sorry about that. With the buttons, you can then button it, or because it is a tube, you can stick your little head in here and wear it bunched up on your neck. And I think that's probably how I'm gonna wear it the most, because I did see someone demo it where they had it wrapped around their neck, and then when it was raining, they kind of pulled it up as a hood. So I'm actually kind of excited about that. I live in California though, so the rain, we totally get some now that we're kind of on our way out of this drought, but we don't have super, super cold weather. We have some bad days, but that's gonna be a lot of yarn on my neck, but I'm excited about it, and I'm so glad to be almost done with it. I've been keeping it in this gorgeous, it's just a white and black, it's a 31 bag, so nice little size if you're ever looking for a project bag. It's called the zipper pouch. No, I'm not a consultant, it was just, I won it in a giveaway, but all fits in there, so all of that fit into this nice thing, and it's like a nice canvas. What else? I'm working on, from a local yarn shop, they kind of put it on as kind of a hey, knit with us, knit along, the Cracker Jack cowl / scarf, whatever you want to make it. It's a free pattern on Ravelry, and I wouldn't consider it really a pattern, more of an idea. And I don't even have like a photo to show you or anything, because it literally is just in the round. And it's for baseball season, and you can do it for any sport really, but baseball works well. You design your colors based on wins and losses of your team and away or home games. So what you do is, let me grab it. Ooh. So I live in California. I'm about 2 hours from San Francisco. So I love the Giants, and I'm doing mine for the San Francisco Giants, which their colors are black and orange. So these are going to be my wins. This is a home win. This is an away win. This is a home loss and an away loss. I have, whoops, this nice gray. So this is what I've gotten so far. I'm about three games behind, but it's only two rows a game, and it's like 54 stitches or something, so I mean I can easily pick that up in an hour. But the pink is a provisional cast on, and at the end of the season you then graft it to the other end and it becomes a cowl. So then it's a cowl that shows you how your team did that year. Well, you can wear it in the postseason. I think if we get into the postseason, what I'll end up doing is just adding like a tinsel or something of gray, like silver, and doing the same colors, but do it with the silver as if, you know, you're in the postseason. But I thought it was cool. I'll probably do like a double stitch or something, embroidery on one of the colors if I get a good patch of the year or something like that, so I know it's not just some random scarf. But super awesome. I actually just got a new yarn pop bag that I'm going to be putting these in tonight and taking some photos and stuff. So I'm excited because, you know, carrying all of this around is going to be hard. But it's a great big size bag. So that's what that I'm working on. My last project is something for my husband. I told you my husband is eccentric. He loves nautical things. He loves mythical creatures. And I love him to death. So he wanted me to make him a hat. It's no problem, babe, I'll make you a hat. What do you want on your hat? And he finds me a pattern. This is a free pattern on Ravelry. It's a squid hat. Yep, that's a squid. This is gonna be on my husband's head. So, again, I said, if you want this, you do it. You pick everything. So he actually found his own yarn, and it's just really pretty. He thought this was a good color for a squid, but it's got like blues and purples and some greens in there. It's kind of hard to see all balled up like this. But he said he's gonna wear it in public. I hope he wears it when I'm not there, but you know, I'm kind of used to his antics at this point. But how this is knit is you start out with making a cap, basically, and then you split it for the tentacles. There are 9 tentacles total, 7 small and then 2 longer ones, just like a real squid, I guess. When you're done with that, you then add on or pick up or graft on, I haven't gotten there yet, the top, which then also has the eyes, and the eyes are actually foam balls that you cut in half. This is a stay-at-home project. I keep it on the side of the bed and I knit a couple rounds a night because it's kind of embarrassing and it's cumbersome. You have to stuff the tentacles as you knit them, and so it's really awkward to carry around. So I've gotten 3 tentacles done, and like I said, this is the part that goes on your head, and I have it on a small cable right now, so it doesn't look like it's really big. I'm really hoping this fits his head because he does have a big head, but I did do the large size. But you basically have to stuff these as you go, and it's on double points right here. And so I don't want to carry this around because I'm knitting, and you've got to keep like flopping these tentacles around. So like I said, I love my husband. I really hope, and I know that he's gonna enjoy the heck out of this, but I'm just gonna complain the whole entire time I make it for him because it's outrageous and just awkward. But like I said, he's gonna love it. I know he will, and that's what I'm working on right now. So hopefully next time I podcast, I've got a little bit more done on some of these projects. I hope to have a couple of them off of my needles so that we can move on to something new. But that's my podcast. That's the first episode of In the Round. I really hope you enjoyed getting to know me and seeing what I've been working on. Hopefully you can take a look at some of these vendors from Stitches and try out some new products, some new designers or whatever. And I'd love to hear what you want to see me talk about. If you want to see my needles or some of my stash, don't hesitate to comment below and I'll read those and see what I can do to help you guys out. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, bye.